Doesn't call us to worship, I don't know what could. Thank you, Lord.
Our hymn is 426. 426. You're going to have to match the choir now and your enthusiasm with this song. Let's stand.
Number 411, Richard.
Let us pray. Lord, we're thankful tonight for that sweet hour of prayer that we're all able to join in and able to commune with Thee. Thankful, Lord, in times of grief and despair, as the song said, we've been able to find relief. We've been able to find solace with Thee. We've been able to find help when we would come to Thee in prayer, because God, You've always been there, attentive to our prayers. And Lord, we come to You tonight with thanksgiving and praise for hearing and answering prayer. Thankful, Lord, for helping us this morning, Lord. Thankful, Lord, for Brother Morgan preaching to us this morning about prayer and the importance of praying, to pray without ceasing, and knowing, oh Lord, that You only work as we pray, and You don't violate Your nature, but You wait for us to request the prayers to Thee. And Lord, that's why we're coming here tonight. Lord, we're not taking this credit, this service for granted tonight, Lord, because we know we need Your help here. Lord, we're asking Thee to come and be with us, Lord, as You've already been here, Lord. We want You to continue to be with us, to help us tonight, Lord. We want Jesus to be seen. We want Him to be uplifted, Lord, tonight. We want bodies to be saved and souls sanctified, Lord. We want, Lord, You to work in all of our hearts and lives as we can commit ourselves to Thee tonight and just give ourselves over to Thee, Lord. You can help us tonight. Oh, we take courage, Lord, tonight to know that You are with us, Lord, and that You've never failed us, and Lord, You hear and answer prayer. We thank Thee, Lord. Now be with us tonight, we pray. Oh, may all that we say and do, oh Lord, be lifting Thee up, and Lord, may we do Thy will tonight, and we'll give Thee the praise for all that's accomplished, for we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen.
Praise Him for it. Thank You, Lord. Praise Him a long time for that, couldn't we?
Yes.
announcements today. Kathy, maybe you're going to say it, but I would say we're glad to have Michael and Carla Hubbard here with us tonight from Michigan. We welcome you here.
Markham, if you could take the microphone to Guy William, please. I believe he has something further to say about the concert.
I just needed to add to this morning's announcement about children for Thursday night. We had a little concern. Public radio is going to record the concert for rebroadcast. So I don't know if you have some infants, you might want to, if you do come with an infant, you might want to be near an exit if you do need to get out quickly. We really haven't planned on a nursery.
Yes.
But just for wisdom's sake, you know, you might want to do that. And also, I needed to announce that something I felt like when I got up this morning, I stumbled around a bit.
No,
I just wanted to mention that this concert has been collaborated on for about 2 years. And the wonderful thing about this is that out of all these entries that came from all over the world, it was an American who was chosen, and someone from Ohio. And we're really thrilled. He is going to be here. I need to clarify that he will be here to receive a cash prize from Monsanto, which is $2,500. And he will be introduced to all of you, and the Maestro Conlon from the West Virginia Symphony will be here, and several other people. Just wanted you to know who is coming so you could make him welcome. It's nice to know. My father-in-law is always inviting people to dinner on Sundays, mm-hmm. and Gaynor never knows who is coming. But she feels better sometimes when she knows who is. So the company that is coming on Thursday night, maybe it's good for you to know so you can feel more comfortable about welcoming them.
Yes.
And so I just wanted to share that little bit tonight and encourage you to, if you can come, to be here for this exciting event. We're real thankful for it.
Thank you, Guy.
Thank you, Guy. I'd like to let you know, some of you know, some of you don't, that David and Rebecca Polly, remember they moved down to Hickory, they have a baby boy. His name is Jonathan David, and he was born on February the 24th.
Oh, well, thank you for telling us.
Also, to let you know that this week is the last week to get your egg orders, Easter egg orders in to Joanne and Genio. Ushers, could you prepare to take our offering, please? Jesus, we thank you and we praise you. Thank you for this day. Thank you for all you've done for us. Thank you for your help, Jesus. We give you glory and honor and praise, Jesus, for all you've done. Thank you for the offering. Thank you, Jesus, for providing for us. And Jesus, I pray that this can be used to the kingdom's use. In thy name I pray, and amen. Thank you.
some wonderful, some glorious things have been spoken of our God and of the city of God. And Michael and Dick are going to sing about that for us.
Things of thee are spoken, Zion, city of our God. He whose word cannot be broken formed thee for his own abode. On the rock of ages founded, what can shake thy sure repose? Salvation's walls surrounded, thou mayst smile at all thy foes. See the streams of living water springing from eternal love. Well, supply thy sons and daughters, and the fear of want remove. Who can faint while such a river ever flows, lets us to assuage grace which like the Lord, the giver, never fails from age to age.
Thank you, Lord. We'll have the other one later. Later, yes. Thank you. Thank you, Mike and Nick. Hallelujah. Well, I gave a brief introduction for Brother Morgan this morning, for this wonderful man, but there's some here who know him better than I have known him for longer. And Dad and Mom Hogue have had a wonderful relationship with this servant of the Lord, and Dad's going to help us be acquainted with him tonight a little better from his experience with him by God's grace. Dad, we're looking forward to hearing a little of this background of this man of God that the Lord has sent to us.
I take pleasure in doing what I'm about to do. The first thing is getting my wife up here with me. This is a girl I married about 52 years ago, was it, when we got married?
Yeah.
And she keeps telling me I'm still handsome, you know.
Oh, well, it's true, too.
I've tell her the same thing. I heard that laugh. Wonderful, wonderful person.
Yes.
We sure love each other. We love the church here, and we want to thank the church for all that you have done for us and you're doing for us now. And I tell you, our 50th anniversary was just something unheard of. I mean, until we had one. I mean, it's just great, and we're thankful for it. Now, that's not what I was supposed to say, but I thought I'd just warm up to this a little
bit. Yes, sir.
It'll very likely be brief, but I think we'll be thorough in what we're trying to do here, Lord helping. First time that we ever met the Morgans was when they were in Anderson College, and wife and I was up there. I was in school that year. And we found out that we lived in the same apartment house. Mm-hmm. Was it the Free?
Freeze.
Freeze apartment house. You probably remember that, Brother Mark. Yeah. And I don't know that we ever talked very much. We'd go in and out. I had a job, and I was in school. She had a job working for Lehman Insurance Company. And I'd see Brother and Sister Morgan come in and maybe see them go out, maybe speak to them. But I'm sure that if we could have gotten acquainted with them then, that we could have had a wonderful time of fellowship. But they weren't there too long, and they moved, and we moved for the same reason not many days hence. Bob don't know that I know the reason why they moved out of the apartment house. Wife just told me today. Sister Freeze told her, and she just told me today, so don't be embarrassed.
Very good. Yeah.
So, I didn't. We You know, when you just see a person and speak to them, you don't know much about them. But we're going to pick up at Wilshire, Ohio. I remember the night I got a call from Wilshire as pastor. We were pastoring at Memphis, Tennessee. And I felt immediately while I was talking to Brother Webb that I was to go to Wilshire, Ohio. I didn't know why, but I think I could relate, but I'll not do that. I'm not supposed to get up here and tell my experience of what's happened to me, only in regard to what we're telling about now. But wife has a story. She'll relate here. Got a few things written down. I hope she won't forget it. And it'll blend in to what we're trying to tell you tonight, okay?
Well, you know, God does work in mysterious ways, his wonders to perform. And Dad said we went to Wilshire, Ohio. We had to go to Wilshire over the objections of our sons. They weren't, they were wonderful boys, but they weren't the men they are now. And they had a lot of...
And they, I don't suppose any of them here tonight.
Okay. No. They had a lot of pride. And we were pastors in Memphis, Tennessee, you know, a city church. And they didn't want us going to this small village church. Wilshire was it was so small, you'd bat your eyes a couple of times and you were through it. Little exaggeration.
600 population, I remember.
Well, anyway, most of our congregation were from across the border in Indiana. They were farmers and people that worked in the city nearby. So I told them, I said, now boys, Dad and I have been pretty well sure of God's will when we went to a place. We would pray. We didn't have the witness talk about today, but we'd always pray and ask for God's direction and tell him to close the doors, and we'd pray till we felt like we'd prayed through. Thank God. I said we will know when we get there to try out. And thank God, and I wished all of you to thank God with me that those days of trying out for a pastor, it's over for us. I just shout and praise the Lord. That is one of, you ought to pray for all the preachers that have to go and give a tryout message, you know, on a tryout day and be questioned by the board. That it's a wonder preachers don't commit suicide more, because that's a bad time. Well, anyway.
Better get discouraged, maybe.
Well, yeah, just they get discouraged. Well, anyway, I said, we'll know when we get there. So I remember that first day when we got there and walking around that church, the Lord just gave me such peace. And I said, well, I feel at home here. I knew we'd be going there. So I'm just telling you that because God did some wonderful things for us while we were in Wilshire.
Thank you, Lord.
And so we moved to Wilshire, Ohio. And life has been the same since.
That's right.
So that fall, we came up short of an evangelist for a revival. Now, in the Church of God, these ministers usually made out their slate at the Anderson Camp meeting. You know, they'd engage an evangelist for the winter revival or the spring and fall revival, which Dad was a good pastor, and he always did that. So, but in the meantime, we moved, and the evangelist he had slated for the Memphis revival, he let him go on to Memphis. But the pastor that just left Wilshire, he wanted to take his evangelist with him to his new pastor, so we were left, and we needed a revival so badly. We didn't have a fall revival, and we needed a winter revival. And we prayed and prayed, and I tell you how the Lord... See, I told you at the beginning, he works in mysterious ways. A lady in that church gave me a beautiful piece of material for a dress. But there was one stipulation. She was going to make it. And she did. And she wasn't a seamstress. And that dress didn't fit me anywhere. And I really had a problem on my hand because I knew that I was expected to wear that dress. And she would really be upset if I didn't wear it. And now she was a modern, you know, uptown woman, Wilshire, uptown. Anyway, I knew that, so we prayed and prayed. What was I going to do? This was, you know, something really troublesome. So I said, well, I'll just go. I'll have to find a seamstress way over. And I inquired and found a real good seamstress way over past Burn, Indiana, clear out the territory so that it wouldn't get back to this dear person that I had gone somewhere to get that dress made over. So I took it, and she had to take it all apart. And then I had to go back for a fitting. And as I was coming back through the countryside, I stopped at one of our members' homes. And this was how it all started with the Morgan. She said, you know, we went down to, said, Brother and Sister Albright, who were song evangelists in the Church of God, and we knew them. She said, we went down to a little Methodist revival last night. Brother and Sister Albright were the song evangelists there. And were they ever glad to see us? And they came home with us for refreshments after church. And said, you know, Brother Albright said that he was a real popular song director for all the revivals around. And so he said, I've helped in many, many revivals. But he said, there is one evangelist that I have helped that I've never heard make a failure. Said he is the most wonderful evangelist in the Church of God. And I said, oh, who was it? She said, well, I believe his name was Roberts. Or I said, no, maybe it was Morgan. Said, oh, I said, could it be Robert Morgan? So she went to the phone and called her husband, and it was. So I rushed home. And I told Dad, I said, what she had told me. And he looked in the yearbook. He said, I'm going to contact Bob. And so he called and called around until he got a hold of Brother Morgan, and he was just up at, I think, at Mentone at that time, or Bourbon somewhere, and he'd had a meeting canceled on him, and he said, well, I can come next week. And Dad said, you come on. And that's how it started. So the day before the revival on Saturday, I tell you, an awful blizzard came. That was a bad winter anyhow. And that blizzard came, and it snowed, and it blowed. And we said, oh, isn't this awful? But see, God was working. And so Brother and Sister Morgan came. They started out, and they had kind of a hard journey to get this, about 100 miles from us. And I'll never forget. When she came in the door, how the snow just whirled around her legs as she came in the front door.
12 inches deep, I think.
Yeah, and they were about the last car that got out of Fort Wayne, Indiana. They closed the highway right behind them. So naturally, the next day, but we were so happy and felt so at peace, even though we said, what's this going to do, this revival? All these, our people lived, most of them, on secondary roads, and the snowplows didn't get back there. But we walked over to the church the next morning, and very few were there. And I think we had to dismiss services that night. But that was all right. Then Monday night, we still couldn't have it. So we were, Sister Morgan was helping me wash. I mean, she was washing the dishes, and I was drying them. And we were talking and having fellowship. And we got to talking about some of the workings of the Holy Spirit. And I said, well, that reminds me of Reese House. And she said, do you know about Reese House? I said, oh, yeah. We started, and she just dried her hands, and she went to the foot of the stairs, and she said, Bob, come down here. These people believe like we do. And so that was our introduction. And from then on, it was just wonderful. You know, we got to resume the meeting, and then this next weekend, Dad calls the boys, and he said, you know, come here. Boys, we found the man we've been looking for. And I still feel like crying. It's so wonderful. Because, you know, we'd searched, there's just many, many wonderful ministers in the Church of God and other ministers. They're just wonderful. But we had never found anyone that believed exactly like we believe or something. I don't know what. We'd have a good time playing Church of God poker, we call it. That's Rook. And but I tell you, Brother and Sister Morgan didn't believe in it, or they didn't practice it. So anyway, he's been with us in meetings since, and that meeting we really got acquainted. He told us about Brother Ham.
Yes.
We tried to get in touch with him. I'll let you go ahead and finish.
Yes, we wanted to call him, and after failed to get in touch with him, Brother Morris said, well, said Brother Everett said, you'll meet him in God's time. Well, what a tremendous statement that is. And so, but was it in that first meeting that the children came up on that Saturday night?
Uh-huh.
I believe it was on that Saturday night, Brother Bob, that you preached on the chief cornerstone being rejected. I don't know how you worded it, but that's the essence of it. And I'm not saying because I'm in his presence, one of the most powerful sermons I ever heard. I heard two others that I related this to. I heard a professor of Cape Girardeau, Missouri Teachers College speak on four things that have caused the world to make the greatest progress. And I was a young minister, and when I left that audience of 200 or 300 ministers, I thought I was walking on air. I thought, oh, God, help me to preach like that, or help me to get excited about preaching the gospel. And then I heard a Methodist bishop up at West Frankfort, Illinois, when we were pastors there, and he preached on the iron did swim. Now, you know what that meant, and the iron did swim. Oh, I thought that was so great. And then Brother Bob came along and preached on the chief cornerstone was rejected. And Oliver came up that night just by himself, except Terry and Kathy came, and Terry and Kathy were not married that particular time. Oliver sitting on the edge of his seat, and you know how I can listen, maybe his mouth part of the way open, and just taking it all in. And I was about like him. I'd look at him once in a while, and keep my eye on Brother Morgan, and it's a powerful, powerful message. And Terry was enjoying it, and when the message closed and sang the song, we may have had some at the altar, but I went back after we said the benediction and started to shake hands with the people, and Kathy, Terry's wife, not then but now, she's the first one out. Well, she passed me up and wouldn't even shake hands with me. And I thought something strange, you know. Terry came out, and Terry's just shaking like this. And I said, Terry, what's the matter? Kathy said she's under conviction. I don't think she was a Christian. That I may be going to church and, you know, like a lot of people, but really hadn't had a personal experience with the Lord. Well, Terry came out shaking my hand and said, Dad, I've heard of many a sermon. That's the greatest I ever heard. At least it's affecting him that way, and it affected me, and it's affecting Oliver. And when we got over to the parsonage, Oliver told Brother Morgan, said, oh, Brother Morgan, I've been looking for a man that's walked like the men walked in the Old and New Testament, walked with God. You know, Enoch walked with God. And he was looking for somebody walking with God. Well, we found one in Brother Morgan, and later on, of course, Brother Ham. And I thought that was one of the great services that we had while he were there. And I believe that he's held us four or five meetings after that. Mm-hmm. I don't know whether Bob remembers, but last thing he held us for us was at Blacksburg, Virginia.
Mm-hmm.
And we had a wonderful time down there. And we're so glad to just give you a little bit of background of our contact with Brother Sister Mark. Brother, is it about ready for him to come to the pulpit? Brother Morgan, would you come up here? Sister Barbara, would you come up here too? And you stand where I stand on this side.
Let me shake your hand. Good to see you again.
I'm so happy to stand with you and your wife up here. And praise the Lord. Now, this is Brother and Sister Morgan, and you might want to give them a hand while we're up here.
I'll tell you, it's because of Jesus that we got together. Yes. We never would have gotten together. So we'll let all that handcuff and go for Jesus, because we wouldn't be here if it weren't for him.